I've had the great joy of meeting many of the Brooklyn brothers over the years, and even more often than meeting them, hearing about their tremendous and inspiring work to bring the Franciscan tradition of educating the whole person from so many alums of both this institution, St. Francis College, as well as St. Francis Prep. In fact, just a week ago today, so last Monday, I was giving a talk at the Paulus Center in downtown Boston. And beforehand, I was talking with one of the staff members there. And over the course of this very brief conversation, the fact that I was going to come here in a week came up. And the woman I was speaking with, who was on staff there at that ministry center, mentioned right away that she was a proud alum of St. Francis Prep, and then began to speak about what a positive impact the brothers and other faculty and staff had on her. And she is obviously continuing that tradition by serving as a minister in the church. So it really is incredible. The work that you all do here is really fantastic. And to the students that are gathered here, you know, I say that you are indeed blessed to study here, and I want to encourage you to use that privilege well. And again, to the faculty, staff, and especially the Brooklyn brothers, I say thank you for all that you do. As Brother Bill mentioned, in my first book, Dating God, I talk a little bit about Franciscan spirituality, a little bit about prayer, a little bit about what that means for today. And that is, in a sense, the starting point for today's presentation. But I'd like to take it to another level, to take it just a step further and apply it, perhaps, to us today. And I want to talk about three different themes: struggle, prayer, and discernment. And that theme, that metaphor of dating God, may come up a little bit more in that second theme, which is prayer. I think it's timely to pause and reflect on the meaning and significance of the legacies of St. Francis and St. Clare of Assisi at this very important time of the year, during which the college dedicates a week to celebrating its spiritual and historical roots. Yet, it strikes me as even more timely that we gather to reflect on the importance of the Franciscan spiritual tradition today, because over the last year and a half, a certain Bishop of Rome, you know who I'm talking about, has helped make all things Franciscan all the rage. I was talking with one of the students here who's a proud Xavier alum, has the Jesuit and Ignatian spiritual tradition in the background, and is now absorbing the rich and deep Franciscan spiritual tradition. So I think it's only fitting to identify the connection there, that it really takes a Jesuit to make Franciscan spirituality a worldwide phenomenon again. Right? But really, if we're honest, it's not as if St. Francis needed the extra boost. Take, for example, a study from 2000. It showed that Francis of Assisi remained the most popular and beloved saint in all of Christianity, second only to Mary, the Mother of God. And Mary is sort of like the Bible on the New York Times bestsellers list. She was taken out of the running. She obviously wins. She's number one bestseller of all time. St. Francis comes in and becomes the de facto winner. Nevertheless, after the first pope who decided to take the name Francis did so, much of the world has scrambled to decipher what exactly this meant. Sure, lots of people know about St. Francis, right? And those of you who teach or work or study here and go out and mention, oh, I go to St. Francis College, or I'm associated with St. Francis College, you probably get some of these reactions. People know something about St. Francis, right? They know, yeah, St. Francis in the birdbath, or St. Francis who loved animals, or St. Francis who loved poverty, or St. Francis, that guy who invented the Christmas creche tradition, right? I love those mangers that we do every time Advent rolls around, and so on, right? But like so many simplistic renderings of ideas and figures, there is, of course, some kernel of truth found in those portrayals. But in light of the inspiring and attention-gathering pontificate of Pope Francis, I believe there's a real important need for us to look more deeply into who this Francis of Assisi guy really was and remains. I believe this is especially true for young adults, those who are college-aged, or those in their 20s and 30s, people like many of you, people like me. I'm part of the oldest end of what's called the millennial generation. I was born in the early 1980s. So I can more or less relate to what it's like to grow up in the world as it appears today, with its dynamically shifting structures, its rapidly developing technology, immediate communication, the rising local and global economic inequality, the world's ostensibly pervasive violence and its, at times, seemingly uncertain future. I mention all of this not to be a downer, but because I believe that the Franciscan spiritual, theological, and otherwise intellectual tradition, with its richness and depth, offers citizens of today's world some helpful insights for our respective journeys in life. I hope that at the end of this presentation, the end of my talk here, you too might see some appeal in the legacy of St. Francis. That legacy, that heritage that St. Francis College celebrates this week. And that legacy and heritage in which each of you participate in some way. So my talk's divided into three parts that offer only the tiniest glimpse into the manifold ways that Franciscan spirituality is appealing and insightful for today. And I mentioned these already. I want to look at struggle, prayer, and discernment. And it seems to me that these three subjects are issues for people of all ages, but they may be especially significant for women and men who are in college or are preparing to graduate. So first, struggle. Although the challenges were different from those of today, Francis of Assisi, who, by the way, was 24 years old when he began to live a new and renewed way of life. And just for effect, not only was he a young adult, somebody in his early 20s, but Clare of Assisi was only 19 when she professed to follow in his religious example of gospel life. Though they grew up in an era very unlike our own, they grew up at a time of unrest and change. While the 13th century saints do not have to navigate, or didn't rather, the technologically saturated neighborhood that is our home today, they did have to negotiate meaning and faith in a time similarly saturated with violence, class struggle, and the emergence of new world views. Francis of Assisi struggled his whole life to understand what God was calling him to do. At the end of his life, he said, "And after the Lord gave me brothers, no one showed me what to do. But the Most High revealed to me that I should live according to the pattern of the Holy Gospel." Looking back at the end of his life on his experience of lifelong conversion and discernment, Francis recognized that he was not in control of his circumstances. He found himself wrestling with what it meant to live in a way pleasing to God while still at the service of others. And it's at the nexus of this evangelical, that is, this gospel life, and ultimately humble service, that Francis encountered his authentic self. It can be easy at times to imagine that these two saints, Francis and Clare, as well as all the other saints we venerate, are so different from us, entirely different, perhaps. You and I, we're regular people, we might say. Francis and Clare, they were special. But if we pause for even a minute and try to be really honest, we come to the realization that they were not, in fact, all that different from us. Neither Francis nor Clare was born a saint, with a capital S. Nor were they born big-time sinners. They entered this world like you and like me, human beings that have an intrinsic relationship with our Creator, a relationship that we can choose to recognize and to develop, or one that we can choose to ignore, and I'll say a little bit more about that when we talk about prayer. They struggled with what to do, but found their direction in finding God. When I think about the struggles of Francis and Clare, these struggles that they encountered throughout their life, I'm reminded of one of my favorite prayers, personally. I feel as though it captures so well what it's like to struggle, and I think it expresses what they experienced, and I think, if you're like me at least, I believe it expresses what so many of us experience. This prayer comes to us from Thomas Merton. How many people have heard of him before? All right, good. Oh, either some shy people in the back, or the light I can't see, or you're don't want to acknowledge that you knew him. Okay, fine, whatever. It looked like there was a fair representation. People are somewhat familiar with him. Well, at one point, this Trappist monk who died in 1968, and who, by the way, was significantly influenced by the Franciscan spiritual tradition, he wrote a prayer in his book, Thoughts of Solitude, that many of you may already know, but I want to share with you. I think it encapsulates this sense of struggle. He prays, "My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope that I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I trust you always. Though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death, I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. What Thomas Merton expresses in this prayer is the foundational struggle that lies at the heart of all human experience. Each of us enters the world of possibility and of risk, of joy and of sorrow, of happiness and of pain. We enter this world without a clear roadmap or instant access to who we truly are and what we are meant to do. It is a struggle indeed, but, and here's the key, it's not an insurmountable struggle. The struggle is at least not insurmountable when we recall, as Saints Francis and Clare did, that life is neither all about us, nor, as Merton implicates and suggests by implicating God, that we're not left alone to figure it out. As Francis prepared for death and reflected on his life, he didn't say this, right? He didn't say, "And no one showed me what to do. So then I just, like, you know, decided on my own to do, you know, this sort of thing." That was a joke. That was Francis, I don't think, spoke like that. You can laugh. It's okay. No, he didn't say that. And of course, he wouldn't have said it like that anyways, but he struggled like Merton struggles in his prayer, like we struggle in our lives. And it was in turning to God and turning to the gospel that his pathway was illuminated, not in his own decision-making, but in relationship with God and one another. Most people think that St. Francis' conversion was an overnight operation. We talk about it, don't we? We talk about it, St. Francis' conversion. You know, some people attribute the singular conversion from a moment where previously Francis had been a pretty bad guy, right? Some biographers refer to him as a playboy. Have you heard that before? Francis was a playboy. Others just consider him a terrible sinner. Sounds familiar, right? This way of thinking began shortly after his death, when Thomas of Celano, his first biographer, was commissioned by the Pope to write the life of St. Francis in preparation for his canonization. See, the idea was that the way you make someone look saintly or holy and getting them ready to be made an official saint is to contrast their life and example with a prior way of life that was sinful or offensive or otherwise unholy, which is exactly what happened in that first biography. But a generation later, we have more time, more space, more clarity, more opportunity for reflection. And this is reflected in St. Bonaventure's account of the life of St. Francis, in which we have a very different, much more balanced picture of the young adult Francis. He was, as it happens, a rather normal guy, probably not unlike many of the young men and women here at St. Francis College. He was a good son, a smart young man, a friendly person, someone who liked to party, someone who probably had a romantic relationship or two, but not someone who was malicious or deliberately evil. Though he wasn't misanthropic, he wasn't really saintly either. And just like most of us in our young adult days, Francis's concerns probably didn't extend much farther than his own life and that of his immediate friends and family. His concerns certainly didn't take into account those on the margins of his society, nor did they focus very much on his relationship with God. Rather than a single conversion, whether we consider it the words of Christ on the cross to him, or the embrace of the leper, or the hearing of the gospel, it is more accurate to talk about Francis's series of conversions, just to make sure there's an S on there. He alludes to this as well in his testament, that reflection at the end of his life, when he recalls at the very beginning that the Lord gave me, Brother Francis, thus to begin doing penance in this way. For when I was in sin, it seemed too bitter for me to see lepers. And the Lord himself led me among them, and I showed mercy to them. And when I left them, What had seemed bitter to me was turned into sweetness of soul and body. And afterwards, I delayed a little and left the world. Only after the fact did Francis recognize that his limited view of humanity, his considering the lepers and others at the margins of his restricted world to be an annoyance or even a disgusting inconvenience, which is how he viewed the lepers at his time. Only after the fact did he realize that this was a form of sin. It wasn't by his own individual effort that he came to have a more capacious view of concern for others, of interest in the lives of others. But he states that it was the Lord that gave him this grace. And it absolutely, 100%, did not happen overnight. In Francis's own words here at the end of his life, he says he delayed a little. It took time before he left the world he had so comfortably known before. Our struggle to understand who we are and who God is and what it is we are called to do in this life is not unlike Francis's own. His story is a reminder that it takes time, effort, patience, and prayer. Francis's own story similarly reflects the journey of a lifelong pilgrimage, one that includes a number of mistakes and learning opportunities. Pope Francis, living up to his namesake, Saint Francis, reveals this to us. At least reveals it to me. This is what I'm hearing him say. Many of you may remember that first full-length interview that Pope Francis gave last fall. Do you remember that? The English translation appeared in a magazine by the name of America. It's a little plug for the Jesuits. In that interview, Pope Francis was very, very honest, right? He begins by answering the question, "Who are you?" And he says, "I am a sinner." And he moves on to reflect on some decisions that he, in fact, regrets, mistakes that he made. For example, when he was the Jesuit superior in Argentina. He wasn't born the Pope Francis we know today, and he's the first to admit that. He has struggled throughout his own life to understand what it is that God was calling him to do. And like his namesake, St. Francis of Assisi, Pope Francis is inspiring so many people all over the world by his words and his actions, by living out that struggle in following the gospel. But how exactly did St. Francis of Assisi and Pope Francis of Argentina face their respective struggles? The answer they both give at various points is simple. But it's an experience that can be very, very challenging and actually counterintuitive. The answer that they both give is prayer. Prayer. It may seem odd to many, and I have no doubt that there's some people in this room that are skeptical that prayer is the answer to the seeming problem of struggling with our identities and paths in life. But I would bet that it's because many of you might be thinking of prayer in terms of things we say or think at particular times and places. That's the big hang-up, right? The Our Father, the Hail Mary, what we do at Mass, what we do, you know, when we haven't studied for a test and desperately need to pass, you know, "Oh God, oh God, oh God, please let me pass, let me pass, let me pass." I know that's not a prayer that's ever said in this college, right? You guys are in the library studying all the time. But these things, these are prayers, right? This is what we mean by prayer. So then it's not surprising that if we think of prayer in that way, then it doesn't seem logical, it doesn't seem to follow that that's the answer, the response to, you know, how do I figure out what I do with my life? How do I come to understand who I am? How do I deal with the struggles that I encounter? But I believe that the Franciscan tradition has a very different understanding of what prayer is and what it means for us. I think that most people can agree on a basic definition. And I'm going to look for a show of hands, or at least head nods, okay, if you're too shy to raise your hand. Can we agree on this? That regardless of what kind of particular prayer we may be talking about, prayer in general is always some kind of communication with God. Sound good? That's what I thought. All right, good. So then I think all these traditional or even non-traditional ways of thinking about prayer can fall under that umbrella. some kind of communication with God. But if prayer is communication with God, then we need to step back and think about the various ways we communicate. We do so with our tone in addition to our words, right? So if I see you and I'm like, so good to see you, right? I'm saying one thing, but I'm communicating something else, right? We do it with our body language, with our presence or our lack of presence. We do so with what we invest our time and energy and money into. We do so in so many ways, right? So let's say, I have a friendship with my brother, Father Brian, and I haven't seen him in a while. You know, picture 2 years down the road. You know, I leave today. He gets really busy with his excellent campus ministry work here. I get really busy doing whatever it is that I do. And I'm like, oh my gosh, Brian, we haven't seen each other in so long. Let's get together. And I'm like, let's meet at Starbucks. We show up there and we sit down and we're so excited. Haven't seen each other in 2 years since that talk with where the fire alarm went off and it was very dramatic. Nobody remembers what Father Dan said because they were so flustered by the fire trucks. It was so exciting. And I say, Brian, haven't seen you since then. What have you been up to? I want to hear all about it. What's happening at St. Francis College? What's happening at campus ministry? Tell me about it. And he gets ready. He's so excited. He's going to tell me. And he starts talking and telling me about everything happening in his life. And I go, uh-huh. Mm-hmm. I'm saying something, right? I'm saying, what's up with you? What's going on? I care about what's happening in your life. I'm interested in you. But I'm communicating something very, very different. St. Augustine and the Franciscan theologian St. Bonaventure after him both said that God is the one who is closer to us than we are to ourselves, which is something I believe that we can all affirm in faith. And if that's true, that God is always already present to us and all that we say and do is indeed closer to us than we are to ourselves, then it follows. We are then always communicating with God, even if we don't realize it. And if we are always communicating with God, then we are, in a sense, by definition, always praying. You didn't see this one coming when you raised your hand, did you? But the question is it a good prayer or a bad prayer? When it comes to prayer, the old saying is true in this case. Our actions so very often do speak louder than words. Francis of Assisi understood this very, very well. There's an expression that's attributed to St. Francis. Perhaps you've heard of it. Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary... Ah, yes, you have heard of it before. Maybe some of you have the bumper sticker, or the t-shirt, or the bracelet, or the hat, or the keychain, right? It's a very popular saying, and now I'm going to exercise my favorite pastime, which is what I call Franciscan Mythbusters. He never said that. He did, however, say something like that, and so I think it captures the spirit of Francis. He said to the brothers in our rule, our way of life, that all the brothers, however, are to preach by their deeds. So it gets across a similar point, but we'll stick with this. Preach the gospel at all times. If necessary, use words. It makes for a better bumper sticker. It is in this phrase, what it's expressing, what it's containing, is this idea that we communicate all the time, especially by our deeds, by what we have done and what we have failed to do. Sounding familiar, right? We know that prayer. We communicate in these ways just as much, probably even more so than with our words. In fact, Thomas of Celano, remember him? He's the guy who painted Francis as such a bad guy in the beginning when he was a young man. He wrote at one point that Francis of Assisi went in his life from saying prayers to his whole life becoming a living prayer. His whole life was a prayer. Sometimes I believe we can say the right words, what we think are the right words. We can be in the right place, think we're in the right place. We can do the right thing or think we can do the right thing at a particular moment, in a particular time. And it looks like, or right on board, it looks like what we might think of as prayer. But what about the rest of the time? What does our whole life communicate? perhaps sometimes it communicates something very different, something entirely else. And I have an example of what I mean by this. There's a movie that came out in the 1970s. Many of you are familiar with it. It's called The Godfather. Does it ring a bell? I want to show you a clip from a very famous scene, and there is some violence in here, so I apologize. It's brief, but it's a very, very powerful scene, and I'll say a little bit more about it in a second. But let's watch this, because I think this represents exactly what I'm talking about.
Michael Francis Rizzi, do you renounce Satan? His works. Baptized in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Michael Rizzi, go in peace and may the Lord be with you.
Seen that before? Again, I apologize for the graphic scenes there with the shootings, but it illustrates, I think, a very extreme version of what I'm trying to say. The Godfather in this case is quite literally a Godfather, right? He's standing in the church, the right place, so one would think. He's saying the right things, right? Standing in not only for the infant to be baptized, who I don't think we saw in this clip, but happens to be a Franciscan friar in the movie. He stands in representing that child's faith, but also the faith of the community as this new Christian is being welcomed into a new relationship in the body of Christ. And he answers the questions that we all answer when we renew and profess our faith, when we profess our creed, right? And at the Easter season, we get the same Q&A. Do you renounce Satan and all his empty promises? I do. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty? I do. On the one hand, he's saying the right things. On the other hand, he's communicating something very, very different. What kind of prayer is the Godfather really communicating with God? See, when we consider only the particular phrases or lines that we say or think to be prayer, then we miss the deeper, more significant insight that Francis helps us see. In a nutshell, that prayer is really about relationship with God. All relationships require communication. All relationships are two-way streets. And such is the case in our relationship with God. See, the way this helps us in our struggles centers on the ways we recognize that two-way street communication with God. Just as we are always already communicating to God by our words and our deeds, to that loving Creator who is closer to us than we are to ourselves, so too God is reaching back to us, actually even before we reach out, reaching to us, communicating with us, revealing who God is to us. But do we see it? Can we hear it? Do we believe it? Francis once told his brother friars that what we are before God, that we are nothing more. The converse is also true, that what we are before God, that we are nothing less. The point is, how God sees us is who we truly are. Meanwhile, so much of our lives, especially these days, center on making and remaking ourselves after the images and the likenesses we see in advertising and TV, the movies, and online. We look outward and judge what it is that we think we should or ought to be based on what we think others want us to be. But Francis and Clare of Assisi both recognized that their true identities were found only in God. To truly find who you are, you must be open to that relationship that's already present. Do we work on a relationship with God? How do we communicate with God? Are we aware that we're already doing it? And what is it that we're actually communicating? The struggle to discover who we are, a struggle that is part and parcel of the human condition, finds its resolution in the love, mercy, and care of God. As Francis of Assisi discovered over time, and at points, and as he points out to us today, we experience that divine love, care, and mercy as we consciously develop our relationship with God and move from just saying prayers to consciously living prayer. Can we do that? Just a little bit about discernment here. I think that today, and perhaps even more so than in the 13th century, all of us, but especially young adults, face the unsettling question, how should I live? What should I do? As I've already suggested, I believe that the cultural environment of our contemporary society, especially here in the U.S., provides the conditions to lure away or distract us from confronting and embracing who we really are and who God really is, ultimately leaving us to settle for the allurements of what is so often our consumer-driven society. In an effort to answer questions of vocation and purpose, contemporary young adults are dealt and sold empty products by a popular culture. Ultimately, that leaves us unhappy and more confused than we began. Now, before I go any further, I need to say not everything in our society that is popular is bad. That's not my point. So don't leave here today and say, Father Dan said we should hate everything in society. We should hate everything in popular culture. I'm never watching Netflix again. That's not my point. And Netflix did not pay me to say that. You know, Hulu Plus or whatever digital way people watch TV and movies and stuff. What I'm suggesting is that we can too easily mistake what the environment around us tells us is important for what God really thinks is important. The consequence, then, of settling for inauthenticity is gravitation toward behavioral models that one sociologist describes as Generation Me when talking about people my age and younger. This is what happens when a millennial, or really, and to be fair, anyone of any generational period, when any of us turns to our popular culture to fill the gap that was once occupied by faith experience. In other words, behavior rooted in consumerism, competition, and self-centeredness arises from embracing this superficial system of identity formation. When people look for identity and meaning in the marketplace, they'll never really find themselves. In fact, that's the secret of the marketplace. Any of you here, I won't ask you to raise your hand, but who are mass communications majors, advertising majors, professors, you know exactly what I mean. I can say that. I was a journalism student in addition to a theology student in college. It's true. Do you use your power for good or evil in advertising? But the whole idea is to convince people that they need something that they didn't think they needed or want something that they previously didn't desire. Francis, who knew the pain of once living an empty life in his time, models the way toward answering this question, what should I do? His answer is basic. It's like I said earlier about prayer. It's listening to God. Thanks to the gifts of technology, medicine, and other sciences, we have been led to believe, given enough time and resources, that humanity can find the answer to any problem unaided. We can do it ourselves. Now we are left, though, with a cultural setting that can be described sometimes as absent of the awareness of God, and a population that has forgotten the source of its very being. It's no wonder, then, that so many in our generation struggle with discovering what they should do and who they are. Throughout the later part of his life, Francis went around to the various communities of his brother friars and preached a series of sermon-like admonitions. They were both critical kind of comments, but also encouraging, trying to get them to live a better Christian life, to follow the gospel more fully. Interestingly enough, these admonitions, these little homilies, aren't really paid as much attention as they should. Most people, when they think of St. Francis, think of writings like the Canticle of the Creatures. But these brief teachings articulate the theological and social view Francis passed on to his followers. And I think that they all 28 or so of them, speak to us today. And because Father Brian said I could talk for 3 hours, I will go through each of them right now in turn. I'm just kidding. I'll talk about three of them very briefly. Yes, I will lose that bet. Three of these, I think, speak specifically to people in their 20s and 30s, college-age students, but to all people in today's time in a special way. The first one is Admonition 7. It's titled, Let Good Action Follow Knowledge. And it's a polemic that warns the early Franciscans of the danger education and social status pose to building relationships with God and others. Now, be careful. Just like I didn't say everything in popular culture is bad necessarily, I absolutely did not say at a college that education is bad. And we got to remember that while St. Francis had his reservations, he did tell his brother Anthony of Padua that it pleases him that he teaches the brothers theology. There is a place for education. But in this admonition, number 7, what he's doing is warning. He's warning his brothers about some of the, when we don't reflect on our experience, what the side effects might be. He was a firm believer that to live simply was the key to authentic gospel life. And he saw in his time how sometimes education, and especially wealth and high social status, could create barriers between people and create a sense of self-sufficiency that disregarded God. Francis wished to end divisions that impaired Christian love. And even those who use their education, wealth, or status to help others must be cautious not to substitute themselves for God. You know, it goes back to even 800 years ago, the sense that maybe is even more common today that we can do it all ourselves. In our time, in what's called the post-Enlightenment era, those of you who study philosophy and history know what I'm talking about. It's a time that's marked by advancement in all technological and scientific fields, and it is wonderful. But I also believe that Francis warns contemporary women and men, not to forget the source of these gifts. Technology is great. Science is important. We are learning so much about ourselves in this great creation that God has created. But do we forget about the Creator in the meantime? With great gifts like our knowledge and our reason and our research and our teaching and our learning comes great responsibility. As we confront questions of future decisions and direction, Francis's advice speaks of the belongingness that can remind this generation of their source and their end. The humility and gratitude that arise from acknowledging God as the source of all good things should lead us to freely share those gifts with others. Hoarding our talents or resources and power for our own good or glory is an injustice. And Francis calls us to use these gifts wisely, serving God and others through good works. Admonition 12, the second one I want to look at, is titled Knowing the Spirit of the Lord. And I think it's a natural progression from this Admonition 7 we just looked at. After recognizing our giftedness as rooted in God's loving generosity, and therefore being moved to share our gifts with others through good works, Francis suggests that we should recognize the direct work of God in our lives. This has a twofold implication. When we do not recognize God's work through us, Francis says that our flesh, which is the term he uses, by which he means our human weakness, gets in the way. If we don't see God's good, then we're probably interfering with its actualization. It also implies that God is always present to us. Remember that? Closer to us than we are to ourselves, whether we like it or not. For us today, the first part of this admonition's meaning has great import for those challenged by uncertainty or confusion concerning the future, looking for keys to discernment. While struggling to discern how to live and what to do, prayerful reflection on where and how God is working in our lives can lead us to see the clearer path ahead. The second part of this admonition speaks directly to the despair and sometimes the feeling of meaninglessness that can often be present in today's culture. It can be difficult to see God's love in our world when we face the violence and illness and poverty that surrounds us. But God's gracious presence is made manifest in our good works. in some way, it is up to each of us to help bring that presence of God to our world. Or as St. Therese said it, right? Jesus Christ has no hands, no feet, no eyes, no ears, no mouth in this world but ours. Finally, admonition 13, which is simply titled Patience, is Francis's proverb on patience in times of trial or distress. Francis draws a connection between the notion of peacemaker from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and the need for trust in God. Francis interprets the peacemaker as the one who is patient, even in the face of the most extreme pain and suffering. There is also a strong connection between patience and humility for St. Francis. When tempted to get upset about situations that render us feeling embarrassed or unappreciated, patience is the humble person's response, acting as God would in the model of Jesus Christ, and not necessarily as our instinct or our ego might have us react. It's only through patience, encountering others where we find them and not where we want them to be, that we can make peace. Women and men looking for meaning and purpose in life are wise to heed Francis's admonition on patience. It can be frustrating to navigate life in a world that is indeed shattered by violence, hatred, and human brokenness. But patience is a virtue intrinsically tied to both inward and outward peacemaking. Inward peacemaking is a needed action for the troubled soul, the confused mind, and the restless heart, lost and confused and troubled by the challenges of our world. So many of us, but especially, I think, millennials, young adults, have been raised in an unprecedented fast-paced society and are desperately in need of some inward peacemaking. I know I am at times. Outward peacemaking, then, is our mode of being, is the mode of being of all healthy relationships. And in recognizing our own needs and weaknesses, it allows us then to be patient, to act patiently with others, and only then can we move to make peace in our world. You can't be a peacemaker if you're impatient, is the punchline. And faced with questions of purpose and meaning, those who strive to live patiently with themselves and others make God's peace present to a world desperately in need of it. So to wrap up, before Father Brian pulls the plug of the microphone. Though the Franciscan spiritual tradition was founded more than 8 centuries ago, it continues to be relevant and insightful today. What I've briefly presented this afternoon is just the smallest tip of just the largest iceberg I can imagine. There's so much more that can be said. And all joking aside, it's a great opportunity to have the time that I have to just share some of these little insights, these little bits of the much bigger picture. When we remember that the founders of the tradition, Francis and Clare, were themselves very much like us, people who struggled with understanding what God had in store for them, who sought to connect to and communicate with God in ever more intimate and ongoing ways, and who discerned how to go about a challenging and changing world, we can begin to see the appeal of this for our world today. To embrace Franciscan spirituality is to embrace the heritage upon which this college was founded, and to embrace the legacy that has and continues to inspire people all around the world, including Pope Francis, that bishop in Rome. In looking to Francis of Assisi and to St. Clare and Bonaventure and Scotus and Anthony and Angela Foligno and others that followed him, we join in a line of women and men who have radically changed the world by being, as St. Clare famously put it, mirrors and reflections of God in that world. May your struggles be transformed by looking to the gospel. May your prayer be transformed to live in conscious communication with the divine. And may your discernment be transformed according to the example and inspiration of Francis of Assisi. I wish you all a blessed and enjoyable Clare and Francis week, and I thank you very much.
So my first question stems from when you're talking about finding yourself in order to, like, find God, and then when you, like, step out of yourself, how that's, like, kind of unhealthy. But do you think those moments when we do step out of ourselves and allow ourselves to be vulnerable with other people, or even if it's just for a brief moment, do you think that aids in the process of finding your true self and then ultimately finding God?
Yeah. Yeah, very good question. And I absolutely do, to answer the second part first. To the first part, I would just reverse that. I would say, not necessarily looking inside ourselves to find God, although that's definitely the case, that God is indeed closer to us than we are to ourselves. But what people like Francis of Assisi, and even more so, I think, somebody like Thomas Merton, who talked a lot about the difference between true self and false self, what they say is that we find who we really are, who we are, as Francis put it, as God sees us. So it's in finding God, and we do, as you put it, move outward. We move outside of our kind of enclosed little world to discover God, and in the process, discover who we are. Now, to your point about going outside of ourselves to others, that's absolutely how we go to find God, how we enter into communication with other people and relationship with others. That's where the Spirit works and moves and gives us life and allows us to know God and to know ourselves. And it is indeed a call to do that. The difference is between that, which is something I think Francis and Clare demonstrated with their lives and their writings and teachings. The difference is to do that as opposed to just to look outside, to look outward in the world to find our meaning and our identity. What Thomas Merton would call the false self, or what St. Francis might say in reverse, what we aren't before God, you know, what we want to think of ourselves, or what we think we should be, or what we'd like to be, as opposed to who we truly are. And so that's the difference. We definitely have to go outside of ourselves to serve one another, care for each other, to truly be brothers and sisters to each other. But we also have to be careful not to be looking outside of ourselves, looking outside of God, to find, you know, who it is that we are. So that's a really great question.
I have one more to just kind of like follow up for that one.
Yeah.
So once we get to our true self and we meet God, does it end there? Does the dating stop there? Or do we still learn more about God and like...
Yeah. It doesn't end. It doesn't end. So, it definitely continues. You know, again, I keep citing Thomas Merton because I think he puts it in terms. He takes the Franciscan tradition of this true self, if you go up in the stairwell, you have all these pictures that say, do you know this Franciscan? Who's this Franciscan? And one of them is John Duns Scotus. And that guy, the first dunce, right? The John Duns Scotus Society is your honor society, right? I think Father Brian was saying, yeah. One of my favorite Franciscan philosophers and theologians. He has very well thought out way of talking about our identities and who it is that we are deep down within. But it's very complicated, and that's why I keep talking about Merton, because he takes it and makes it really accessible. And he talks about this true self and false self. And to your question, one of the things he says, and I think Francis of Assisi points this out both in his words, you know, what we are before God, that we are and nothing more, but also in his lived example of ongoing conversion, is that we can never fully know who it is that we are. Part of that is what Thomas Merton will say is the consequence of original sin. If we think about Genesis 3, right, the story of Adam and Eve, it's not really about snakes and apples at all. That was kind of a joke. Yeah, okay, all right, never mind. Tough crowd here in Brooklyn Heights. It's not about apples and snakes at all. It's about human beings. It's a story, it's our story, about how we can't seem to accept who it is we are before God. We want to be something different, so we succumb to the temptation to eat the forbidden fruit, to try to be something different. What did they want after all? They wanted to be like God. They didn't want to be themselves. And so that's what the false self is. That's what is so difficult. And, you know, in order to really find God, to go deeper into that relationship with the loving Creator who loves and likes us and loves us into existence, means we have to kind of turn down the noise sometimes in the world around us, which is telling us, kind of like that snake, you know, eat this apple, eat this apple, eat this apple, be like God, be something other than who you are. You don't look right, you don't sound right, you don't think right, you don't act right. That's what advertising is, right? You know, L'Oreal isn't just about shampoo, it's about being in that garden. So, I think it's an ongoing experience, and we only fully know when we open ourselves up to trying to see ourselves and one another through those eyes of God.
Okay, so I know that in your book, of course, you compare the relationship with God to a normal relationship that we would have, which I do think is a really good comparison. I just want to say, reading the book, I found it really easy to understand when it was put that way. I think I have a question about something I feel that people struggle with, whether it be a relationship with God or just a normal relationship, is how to, I guess, continue, how to have the strength to continue your relationship and your faith when you feel as if you've been scorned or you've been forgotten by it. To use an example, I have a grandmother who, since she was in her 20s, has really dedicated her whole life to God. She teaches religion classes. She brings the Eucharist to, you know, nursing homes or to people who aren't able to get it themselves. And 10 years ago, her son, my uncle, passed away, you know, tragically. He was only 35. And she took it in stride, but a lot of people, even myself included, seem to ask her, how do you have the strength to still continue such a big part of your faith when it almost seems as if it is turned away from you when you needed it most?
Yeah, that's a very, very, first of all, sorry for your family's loss and your uncle, but that's a very powerful and hard question, and I fear that the answer is not nearly as powerful and equally difficult. And that's, we don't always know. I think sometimes, this goes back to conceptions that we have of what prayer is and what it isn't. Oftentimes, and you know, I've talked about this before in terms of, you know, it's analogous to the prayer about passing the test, that oftentimes men and women, or there's that expression, right? There were no atheists in foxholes during war. In these situations, when we're pushed up against the wall, when we suffer some tragic loss or in deep pain, that's when we start crying out to God, right? And somehow then it becomes God's responsibility and God's fault or God's whatever it may be. And to some extent, we can talk about it in those terms, although that doesn't really resolve the struggle and the pain that we encounter. You know, one of the things that is really, really difficult to accept is that we do, in this world that we live in, which is finite, which isn't perfect, in which we have free will and sometimes hurt other people and are hurt and suffer a lot of pain, that we're not going to have a definitive answer, a right-away answer. So much, the term for that is, in theology, theodicy. It's the reflection on how is it that we can say God is all loving and all good, yet bad things happen to good people sometimes. You know, the book of Job is a great illustration of exactly how that plays out in Hebrew scriptures. And of course, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ is a great example, and the persecution and so on and so forth. We have all these encounters of things that don't seem to add up. By way of an example of how somebody may be a model for that, I look to somebody like Mother Teresa, you know, the founder of the Missionaries of Charity. It was only after her death that her journals and correspondence with her spiritual director were made public and were given permission to publish them. And something very striking, if you didn't know this, you should look into it and read them. It's incredibly mind-blowing, especially to people who look to her and see how she struggled and gave so much of herself in her life, serving, you know, as she put it so you know, so famously, the poorest of the poor. That in the last years of her life, many, many years, more than a decade, she felt as though God's presence was gone. She wasn't even sure, as she writes in her journals and correspondence, she doubted that God existed. She had no connection. And it's mind-blowing to those of us who look to her and say, well, surely this person who gave so much of herself, she must have had this very intimate, close relationship with God. That's where she got her strength, right? Well, how is it that she continues to live on and do such good work, such powerful ministry, such witness to as St. Teresa put it, you know, the hands and feet and mind and a love of Christ that she brought to the world in her actions. I think she provides a model, but it remains still a mystery. How do we reconcile this? Our relationship with God that seems to be absent, that seems to be painful at times. I think what Mother Teresa shows to me anyways is that what we're called to do is exactly what the good news, what the gospel tells us. And that when God entered the world as one of us, even amidst pain and suffering and loss, when all of his family and friends, with the exception of his mother and just a handful of people, abandoned him, turned him in, killed him and crucified him, scorned him and ignored him, that, you know, the thing is to keep doing, as he put it, the Father's will of God. And so that is my very long, very maybe unsatisfying, but nevertheless challenging response. And that is a question that we all struggle with. So thank you so much for bringing it up.
Thank you.